Welcome to this election special episode of The Vote. Today we'll be focusing on the council elections, which take place on May the 2nd. And we'll have a specific focus on the Queen's Park ward, which is in central Brighton. That seat has three councillors in it, currently all Labour. And today we're speaking to the Green candidates, Martin Farley and Clare Rainey. Two of the three candidates standing in the election. Plus, in the second half, we'll be speaking to the three Conservative candidates, who are Josephine O'Carroll, James Noble, and Lee Farmer. We'll be asking the same questions to each of the candidates today, and hopefully we'll get a greater insight into some of the key issues affecting the ward, including transport, housing, particularly the housing crisis in and around Brighton, and also a bit about what they like about Brighton and what they want to see improved. So enjoy the show. As I say, this will be the first of a series of the votes which focus on key wards in the city, and hopefully you'll get a greater insight into what the candidates are going to be standing for. Many thanks. Today by the Greens Council, Green Party Council candidates for the Queen's Park ward in Brighton. Clare, Rainey and Martin Farley, welcome to Latest TV.
Hey.
I'm just going to really briefly go through why you're standing for the Green Party in Queen's Park and just go through some of your policies and your ideas. So, okay. Did you, Clare, go first, introduce yourself?
Okay, I'm Clare Rainey. I've lived in Queen's Park ward for nearly 17 years, so I've got a really good understanding of the issues facing the residents there. You know, I've got lots of personal connections there. And, you know, I work in Brighton as well. And what we really want to do is look at development in the ward, really help with youth services, particularly the development of Brighton Youth Centre, which is going ahead at the moment. And just to, within the ward, tackle the issues facing the whole city, such as homelessness, recycling, that kind of thing.
Martin, tell us about yourself.
Yeah, so I'm Martin Farley, and I've only lived in Brighton for about 5 years, and I work in London for the moment, so I'm one of the Southern Fail commuters. So I have a lot of empathy for people
who
also have to do that.
Yeah.
But for me, I mean, one of the reasons I'm standing, I spend a lot of time out and about in Brighton. I walk my dog all over the city. I run along the seafront. I'm out in Queen's Park a lot. I'm out in Kemp Town a lot. So for me, it was really about, you know, I love this city and I think it's a great place to be. I'm really just wanting to sort of contribute to the development of this area, make sure that other people get to enjoy it to its absolute maximum potential. And so the things that Clare mentioned, but also, you know, just ensuring that we can get around safely and cleanly and sort of in a way that kind of supports our broader environmental concerns as well.
Yeah, and I know you're launching your manifesto next week, I think.
That's correct, yeah.
So we can cover that when it comes out. But in the meantime, what are your main policy issues in Queen's Park? Because it's one of the key wards, really, isn't it?
It is one of the key wards, and it's a ward which encompasses lots of different areas of Brighton. We've got the seafront, we've got St James's Street, we've got Kemp Town, we've got the residential area around Queen's Park, and then heading out to the Downs. So we've got lots of different areas and lots of different
potential issues
to tackle.
Yeah.
So I know you're interested in housing, so how would you tackle the housing crisis in Brighton?
I think for us, the starting point for that is, you know, the Labour administration has had access to about £41 million worth of funding for housing, and it's only accessed about a quarter of it. So the starting point for us is to make sure that we access all the funding we can to support building houses, supporting homelessness and rough sleeping, and bringing empty properties back into use. And we have a good record of that. In the last Green administration, we brought about 600 new council homes back into use. The starting point is we need to access the funding that is there and to really focus it on the people who need it most. And just yesterday at the council budget meeting, the Green amendment to improve and extend support to homeless and rough sleepers was passed. So it's a priority for us, and we're working on it all the time, but that's definitely something that should be at the forefront and is particularly key for an area like Queen's Park, which is a city centre ward and really therefore absorbs a lot more of those problems and challenges than some other wards, I think.
We've also promoted the use of unused council houses for emergency shelters for homeless people, and we continue to promote the building of new council homes and affordable homes on brownfield sites and using unused sites within the city as well.
Okay, on transport issues, you often campaign on transport, greener transport. So any ideas on how you might improve the particular links around the Queen's Park area, although they're pretty good with the bus service already?
Yeah.
I mean, I think for us, if you look at some of the things we've done in the past, we've been quite innovative with transport, the bike share scheme, the city car club, extending bicycle lanes, bus lanes, The Valley Gardens project that's underway at the moment, which really will improve pedestrian and cycling experiences in and around the ward, but really continue in that vein and make sure that at the forefront of those decisions are safety, environmentally friendly means of getting around, but also improving bus services and making sure, the bus service isn't directly accountable to the council, it's a private company, but we can lobby them and we can sort of pressure them to provide the services that we need and to make sure that those are available.
Yeah, and just to add, in terms of safety, the 20 mile an hour zone has been applied to a lot of Queen's Park Ward, but we would look to enforce that more and possibly extend it as well.
Okay, and you both live in the city, don't you? So,
yes.
I mean, what do you like best about Brighton? And what do you do to improve it, just in general terms, really?
Okay.
Clare, we'll start with you.
Yeah, I absolutely love Brighton. I mean, I grew up in London, and compared to London, we've got so many natural resources. I live in Queen's Park Ward, and I've got the beach at the end of my road. I've got the Downs virtually at the other end of my road. And it's also really creative, really culturally diverse, very inclusive. I've brought my kids up here. It's a great place because there's so much going on in terms of outdoor stuff, arts and crafts, all that kind of thing. I just think it's a fantastic city. I absolutely love it. I wouldn't live anywhere else, really.
Great. Yeah. Okay, Martin.
That was kind of my answer too. But I suppose all I would add to that, not everywhere is like Brighton. I mean, it is a great place to be. There's something for everybody. It's a very open and tolerant place to live. I used to live in London. I'm from Liverpool. I love being by the sea, but I just love the mix of people that we have. It's not just one group of people. I used to come down to Brighton a lot and go out in the gay scene, but actually there's a whole other scene to Brighton as well. Beyond that I really enjoy the food, the drinking, so I just think there's something for everybody. It's a great place to meet lots of different people, and not everywhere is like that, and we should really work hard to preserve and develop that aspect of the city. I think we're both very committed to that for this area.
Yeah, and make sure everyone who lives in Brighton can benefit from everything that it's got to offer.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, just lastly, how can people find out more information about yourselves? We've got the Green Party website, but I guess you're going to be out and about knocking on doors.
Yes, we're going to be out. We've already been out leafleting. We're going to do more leafleting. We're going to be out knocking on doors this weekend and in the future.
Yeah.
But we do also have a Facebook page, which is Queen's Park Greens Brighton, or Queen's Park Brighton Greens, one or the other.
We'll put the details up on the screen.
Yeah, okay, cool. Yeah. And a Twitter account as well that people can follow. So we'll try and get as much information up there as well over the next couple of months up until the election for people to look at.
Great. OK, Clare and Martin, all the best for the campaign, and thanks for coming into Latest TV.
Thank you. Cheers.
Well, there is also a big message that the club wants to send to the world.
The steer from the administration is not as firm as it should be.
The budget then, so what would be the process for the opposition?
We've got the hospital development going on, we've got major developments everywhere.
Because they created their own regions. We now have a situation where taxi drivers come from Portsmouth, they come from Chichester.
Hi, I'm Mark Walker and you can catch me in conversation with the people who make the city great in my weekly programme, The Vote. Today by Lee Farmer, Josephine O'Carroll and James Noble. You'll hear you're the Conservative candidates for the Queen's Park Ward on Brighton Council. We've got an election on the 2nd of May. So welcome to Latest TV.
Thank you.
I just want to start off by just if you all introduce yourself, we'll start.
Yeah,
start
sure. Well, my name's Lee Farmer. Yeah. I live and work in the Queen's Park Ward. I work for American Express.
Yeah.
And I've lived in Brighton for about 20 years.
Great. Okay.
I'm Josephine O'Carroll. Yeah. I also live in the Queen's Park Ward, just off St James Street. I'm retired, so I've got 7 days a week available, and I thought I'd try and do something back for the community.
Great. OK, and James?
Hello, I'm James Noble. Yeah. I live in the Queen's Park Ward, and I do research for drug discovery into bipolar disorder at Sussex University at the moment.
That's really interesting. Great. Why are you standing for the Queen's Park Ward? What do you like best about the Queen's Park area? Because it's quite a central area of Brighton, a key
it
area.
It is. No, I love living in the city. It's a dynamic, exciting place to be. But my niece and nephew visited about 6 months ago, and they're only 10 and 13, and they were quite scared walking around. It was a real eye-opener. I saw the city through their eyes. And they saw a lot of people that were street homeless or rough sleeping. They saw a lot of drug taking. They saw a lot of graffiti. There was an attack and a murder in the city while they were here. And it was quite an eye-opener to see the city through their eyes.
Yeah.
Although I love it, there are problems, and quite a few problems. They were saying, where are the bins, Lee? There's no bins in this town. Or why is the graffiti everywhere? And what's that smell that we can smell as you're walking past doorways, and you know, they can people smoking or what have you. So I think there are issues, and that's one of the reasons why I wanted to stand and to give something back.
Okay, Josephine.
I'm retired.
Yeah.
I've had two good careers in the Air Force and then as an engineer.
Yeah.
I lived in Brighton now for 8 years. I see the issues that are going on, and I thought it's about time that I started giving something back to the community. I have the time to do it. Somebody's got to do it, so I thought it should be me. As to why I'm standing there as a Conservative, well, I grew up through the eras in the 70s and the 80s when I saw things like Militant and Momentum, and I thought the Conservatives were my natural home.
OK, that's great. And James?
So while I'm standing, recently we've had a lot of things happening in the city where residents don't feel like they've been properly consulted. This is crystallised by the Valley Gardens Phase 3 in this ward. And I'm just feeling that in this time of politics, people are losing faith, and I don't want them to do that on a national on a local level. So I'm fighting to hopefully ensure that residents are properly listened to and consulted to, these big developments which are going to change the face of Brighton forever.
Yeah, and just some of the big issues, really. St James's Street is one of the key areas, really. You know, a lot of people use it every day, and it's a great place to shop and to be. But what are your thoughts on St James's Street? Do you think it...
Well, we all spend a lot of time in St James's Street, whether it's walking to work or going out and socialising or buying from the independent shops there. And, you know, there are definitely room for improvement. I think Josephine had some thoughts about the park and areas around St James's Street.
Yeah. Well, Dorset Gardens.
Yeah, well, there is Dorset Gardens. there is work being done. I mean, there are grants coming from things like Pride. They're putting the lights in the trees on the street. We're getting planters and work on the gardens.
Yeah.
There's a outdoor gym going to be going into to Dorset Gardens. If there was one thing I could say about St James Street, it is an area which has been sadly neglected over the last few years. It does need work done on it to brighten it up. But it is a microcosm of life, both in the world and in the country. I mean, we have our own TV studio and our own newspaper, so it's...
yeah, great. What about the housing crisis? You know, there's a lot of students living in Queen's Park and kind of a lot of HMOs, but also, you know, other residents as well. So how would... any thoughts on the housing crisis? And is that going to form part of your campaign?
Yeah,
it's one of the biggest issues.
At the moment, we saw... there was a budget last night.
Yeah.
And we saw Green and Labour councillors vote through policies which are going to take away the receipts from the Help to Buy scheme and fund that into other projects instead of replacing the housing stock of social housing that is being sold off through that way and helping people onto the housing ladder. That should be replaced back into creating more council homes and more social housing, which is desperately needed in the city. And the council is funneling that money away from social housing and using it on other projects, which is just unacceptable.
Yeah, and we should say that's the budget meeting which happened last night, so 28th of February. Yes. Any, Josephine, Lee, any thoughts on the housing crisis?
Well, I think, you know, everyone has a right to live and be comfortable and be accommodated, and it's a tragedy when you see people that are sleeping rough on the streets or are living in accommodation that's totally unsuitable for them. So it's certainly a priority for all of us to accommodate people safely and affordably in the city.
Yeah. Josephine, anything to add?
I know there is about £160 million has been directed from Conservative government down towards the councils to help deal with homelessness problems. And again, as I understand it, that's been misdirected and isn't being used for that purpose by the present council. So it would be nice to see a council that actually spends it for the reason it was given it.
I should say, I know your manifesto, I think it's coming out, the Conservative manifesto to Queen's Park, so we'll look forward to showing that. We'll be covering that latest news. So just lastly, transport, that's a big issue. I think we do have excellent bus links around Queen's Park, but how do you improve transport links? Any ideas on that?
Well, certainly Valley Gardens is a big issue for all of us.
Phase 3.
I mean, we've been working with the local community groups, particularly the Valley Gardens Forum, in trying to... We're doing a petition at the moment where we've already got almost 1,000 signatures to pause and get a consultation on Valley Gardens Phase 3. Again, we just don't think the local businesses, the residents, the people who have expertise in this ward, in this area, in Brighton, have not had a say on Valley Gardens Phase 3. They do not feel like they have. And it's going to be bad for business, it's going to be bad for pollution, it's going to be bad for traffic, it's going to be bad for cyclists, it's going to be bad for pedestrians, and it's going to be bad for the tourism industry, which our city relies on. It's going to divide Brighton in half with 5 lanes of intense traffic. It's hard crossing the 3 or 4 lanes that there are there now, you know, small families and kids. It's going to be a death trap.
There's definitely a lack of understanding. Certainly before I started reading into it, you know, I saw one flyer on a wall and, you know, it's such a major thing for the city that everyone needs to really understand the scope of what's possibly going to happen.
Yeah. And I think the consultation started in October, so that's been one of the big concerns. So let's see how that progresses. You're all great fans of Brighton. We all are. So just maybe start with Lee, what makes Brighton great?
Well, I think part of it is just the history of the place. You know, it's amazing to walk around and see the pavilion and the piers, but then that's also very depressing because you've got such beautiful buildings, you know, the Pepper Pot in Queen's Park or Madeira Terraces that are just neglected. And, you know, money needs to be spent on those. You know, the council is letting these assets of the city just go into disrepair. Yeah. And I think it's quite shocking because that is part of the character of the... And it's also very unsafe because, you know, you'll go past the terraces now and you'll see, you know, needles on the floor and, you know, rubbish piled up. But so many buildings, not just in Queen's Park, even the Hippodrome on Middle Street, you know...
Yeah.
The Beatles played there, Charlie Chaplin played there, you know, and now it's a disused bingo hall that needs to be turned into something. And, you know, it's very depressing, I think, that, you know, these buildings are left to rot. And, of course, there's different priorities and, you know, everything's important, but, you know, money's there and there are, you know, groups that are wanting to protect these assets to the city that could be better supported by the council, and certainly that's something we would support.
OK. Josephine, anything to add? I mean, what makes Brighton great? I know you're a big fan.
Well, one of the big... pardon me. One of the big things is the cultural life.
Yeah.
In particular, you have things like the Fringe, you have the Brighton Festival, you have Pride, and they're all driven by tourism and welcoming people into Brighton. And I think we need to do as much as we can to encourage people to visit Brighton and enjoy the life and, like, us enjoy their company.
Yeah, James, you go to the University of Sussex, don't you? So you're near the Amex Stadium, so that's one good reason to
like. I grew up in Brighton. I now do my research in Brighton.
Yeah.
So I've seen it, you know, throughout my childhood and now as a young adult. And the thing that makes Brighton great is the people of Brighton. I don't think there are other places like this in the UK. I think it is a very special place, and I think we need to fight to keep it that way and make sure that it is given the resources and protecting our local heritage. I think is really important. I mean, I met one girl today who owns a business down in the Arches who felt like she had lost hope, and we've got to stop that from happening.
Okay. Lee, Josephine, James, thanks for coming into the latest TV today, and all the best for your campaign.
Appreciate it. Thank you.
Thanks.